You're listening to Thunder Quack Podcast Network.
From across the stars, Commanders Michael Cohen, Matthew Krenke, and their ragtag crew are here to bring you stories of adventure and excitement from a galaxy far, far away. Get ready for tales of merciless bounty hunters, courageous heroes, and sinister villains from the core worlds to the Outer Rim and beyond. Buckle up, baby. It's about to get faster, more intense.
Hello there, and welcome back to Faster, More Intense, a Star Wars podcast. We are back after a pretty sizable little hiatus there with some Star Wars conversation. I am, as always, your host, Michael Cohen, and on this episode, we've got a special guest, Will Beamon from Cantina Conversations. How's it going, Will?
It's going great. How are you today?
I am awesome. I'm ready to talk about some Star Wars. We don't really have a ton planned. We had sort of this is a conversation that this is one of the reasons why it's been a little bit, is that there were some scheduling issues, not just you, Will. I had 3 weeks in a row where stuff just didn't go right, where other people couldn't or weren't feeling well, and then there was a week where I had to cancel. Like, it was just one thing after another, but we're back. It was actually kind of nice to have a little bit of a break, but we're in the lead up to The Mandalorian. We got that sneak peek during Monday Night Football, and we were like, when I messaged you, I'm like, hey man, you want to come on this week and we'll talk about that Mando sneak peek. And you were like, yeah, sure. And I was like, this will be good. We'll have a little bit of meat to talk about. And then they release it. And look, I'm not one of the people who was like, this is going to be incredible. They're going to show us Boba Fett, and they're going to show us Ahsoka, and they're going to show Ezra, and they're going to show Thrawn, and they're going to show Kylo Ren. And it's going to, like, because there were people online who were like, man, this is going to be the greatest trailer of all time. And it's like, no, it's a TV spot during Monday Night Football. It's going to be 30 seconds tops. But I was hoping that we'd get something with a little, not, it's not that it doesn't have substance, but it was really just almost like extensions of half of the scenes from the trailer that we got a few weeks ago. So it was kind of like, okay, there's something there. There's a little bit there, but it's not a full episode. This does not make, so we're going to free flow it. Will, you and I, we've never really talked before other than some light social media interaction, right? Mostly on the Kind of Funny Facebook page or group, Facebook group, because we're both fans of Kind of Funny and the handsome young men over there at Kind of Funny. So really, I think we're just going to get to know each other. This is
okay.
It's kind of like, this is kind of like internet Star Wars friend dating.
That's right. Is there like speed rounds and everything too?
Yeah. Cause by the end of this episode, I'll ask you the question of whether or not you want to have another Star Wars conversation with me. We can take it from there.
Yeah.
Cool. But you are a Star Wars podcaster. You have your own Star Wars podcast.
Yes. Yes, I am.
I tell people a little bit about your Star Wars podcast before we get into.
Okay. Well, my show's called The Cantina Conversations, and it's one that I started with my two Canadian friends, DJ and Jackson. And I approached them, I think it was right after Star Wars Celebration for The Last Jedi. And I said, hey, I'm really looking into getting into Star Wars, just a Star Wars specific podcast, because I used to be a co-host of a podcast called The Game Chair for a while, and that covered like video games, movies, TVs, and everything. But then the people I did that with got jobs, those losers. So they weren't able to record with me anymore. so I was left without a podcast for a while, and I knew if I ever returned to the podcasting game, I wanted to just do a Star Wars focused show. So I started it with them, and we went through like all the films and some Star Wars episodes and stuff, and then I got a different job. So it was like how my previous podcast ended because my other host got jobs. I ended up getting a job that had that still has some pretty crazy hours, but I went from my job, which had very flexible scheduling, to where I unfortunately lost my job, so I had all the time in the world while we were recording, to a job with like this crazy schedule. So we had to go on hiatus for a while. We did two live streams over like the lockdown period because no one was leaving their house, so like there was nothing else to do. So we got the band back together for two live streams, and then we went back on hiatus again. But we're kind of at that life spot now where we figured out the life work balance again, and it just happened to be lining up with Mandalorian. We were thinking about coming back about a month ago, but we were like, let's just wait until Mandalorian season two. It'd be a much better time to come back.
Yeah.
Because our show about the Mandalorian is called Mando Mondays. That's our series that we did about the Mandalorian in review. And then this year, Disney and Lucasfilm are doing their own thing called Mando Monday, where they're doing merch and stuff. So we've been jokingly saying our show is doing the cease and desist from Disney 2020 challenge. But yeah, so we're very excited to be back. I'm very excited to be back. Because I did miss it a lot because we have a lot of fun with it. But I'm pretty excited to hit the podcasting waves again.
Yeah, it's Star Wars is a funny thing, and I think that people who listen to this and have listened to Rebel Cells, my other Star Wars podcast, will know that I like to cover the shows, right? Like that's the sort of podcast that when I started listening to podcasts, that's what I listened to, and so when it came time for them to do Clone Wars, when that was about to hit, I was like, oh, perfect. I'm gonna do the Clone Wars recap podcast, like a dedicated one. This is way back in 2008, back before anyone was even listening to podcasts. So there were only like 12 of us making them on the internet. And it was really nice because there was the Force cast, and there were like a handful of other Star Wars podcasts, but I was the first one to do that, like dedicated. We're just going to talk about like a recap of each episode of the Clone Wars. And then my co-host Matt, he joined me in season two. And we've kind of just covered the animated stuff since then. And then last year with Mando, we spun this show out, Faster, More Intense, specifically to cover the live action content, because Rebel Cells is dedicated to the animated content. It kind of like ebbs and flows, because otherwise you're having to figure out like week to week, kind of like the conversation that we had at the beginning of this, like, what are we going to talk about? And sometimes it's easy. Sometimes you can just like sort of spin up a topic, like a top five, who are your top five favorite droids or something like that, which you can have some fun conversations from, but it's a little bit like, that's definitely more work than when the shows are on, or there's a movie coming out and we can just go like, let's just talk about it. Like, let's just go. Cause we can talk about this trailer. We can talk about these set shots or whatever. Right.
Yeah. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
No, it's all good. I'm just excited for Mando to come back.
Yeah, I am too.
So that we can cover that.
Yeah. And it's like the unfortunate thing about like when my show went on hiatus was like, we were just starting to hit our stride of conversational topics because even though I make no money off of Star Wars, I dedicate way too much of my life on it. So I was nowhere near running out a shortage of conversation topics I wanted to have with the boys, as I call them. But it just like, we got so busy, we didn't even get to cover the final season of Clone Wars.
Oh yeah.
So like, we left all that content untouched too, just because there was nothing I could do. And But so I mean, we might go back in kind of hindsight and to
it is, yeah, it's absolutely
lead up to Bad Batch maybe, but
It's evergreen, man. I you want to do recaps of those things? We get downloads for season one of Clone Wars, for because the show that we started with, it was originally called Frontlines, the Clone Wars podcast. People mm-hmm. still download the entire catalog of episodes as because there's constantly new people jumping onto the shows, right?
Right. Well, because there's always kids turning eight and watching Clone Wars for the first time, and so they're gonna want to learn about it.
Yeah,
that's the good thing about Star Wars, is it's so generational.
It's 100% evergreen.
Like, every 5 years, there's a new age group that's getting through all of this stuff and is ready to start learning a little more about it. It's like a never-ending cycle of audience for you.
Yeah, yeah. So you can always go back. We went back a couple of years ago now and did, for our 10-year anniversary, in 2018, and we redid season one of Clone Wars because Matt wasn't on season one with me, so and the audio quality for season one was awful, so we went back and we just called it Clone Wars Special Edition, and we didn't go episode by episode in the same way that we normally would when they're coming out week to week. We went arc by arc, but we still did recaps. We still would go through the whole sort of thing, but which was easier in season one than in other ones, because I think it's there are 2 3 parters in season one as opposed to the 4 parters that you get into in later seasons, but you can always go back, you can always check that stuff out, and cover it again, because people, I mean, like if people like hearing you talk about Star Wars, I find that it's just about finding people who think like sort of feel the same way about Star Wars that you do, but then have maybe different opinions on it, right? Like as long as that core is the same of like, why is Star Wars important to you? I think it leads to great conversations,
right? And that's something that's probably my main goal with any content that I make, is just to try to have a welcoming and positive experience with Star Wars, because it's so easy to get sucked into the negativity online. Totally. And I can't even say it's just something that happens with the new movies either, because it was there with the prequels, whether think it was or not. It's just back then, all of that stuff was concentrated into forum websites, because that's how that stuff happened. Yeah. Like, Twitter and Facebook are pretty much a more socialized version of forum sites. So that's why it's just so bad now, is everyone's got access to it. Before, it would just be the people like you and I that would be dressed up as a character for the movies on these forums. Well, now everyone's got that exposure. Yeah. So
I liken it to with the forum stuff. Like, I remember like the Jedi Council forums and stuff like that back in the day on FanForce and Force.net and stuff like that. Those are closed rooms, right? Like where it's like you come into a room and it's like, oh, in this room everybody's talking about Clone Wars, in this room everybody's talking about Dark Forces video games, in this one they're all talking about Knights of the Old Republic, right? Like you kind of go, you could find your people to hang out with and the topics that you wanted to dig into. Right. Nowadays with social media, especially Twitter, it's instead of it being like you're walking into a room full of people who are there to talk about that topic, instead, Twitter, I liken it to standing on the side of the street and just yelling out your opinions and hoping that somebody walking by is like, yeah, man, totally. Yeah. But I mean, like, try it sometime. Try and just go stand on a street corner and yell your opinion. Most people are just going to tell you to shut up. So, I mean, there's obviously the communities that form within that, but in general, it is very much like it's this weird, non-futile version of just screaming into the void. And as an artist, like I've been doing Inktober all month long, all October, which is a daily drawing challenge, and I decided this year that I was going to do 31 days of Star Wars. It's really funny to be putting this stuff out every day and see what hits with people and what doesn't, and just sort of like throwing that stuff out there. But it is very much like it's putting a piece of yourself out for criticism. Yeah. And it's like Instagram, Instagram's been great. I've gotten lots of really great positive feedback. Twitter has been a little bit less exciting. I don't think that it's really the place for that kind of content. Mm-hmm. And then Facebook is obviously just all of my friends and family telling me what a great job I'm doing, which I don't trust. Right.
Right.
It's like, yeah, I know you guys like me. You're my friends and family. That's not what I'm looking for. I'm looking for the acceptance of complete strangers right now.
Exactly.
But it's funny because I went into a Discord that I'm a part of and posted. I did a drawing of Palpatine because it's like the way that Inktober works is with the regular Inktober, there are prompts and they're very general, like run or hide or something like that. And it's just to kind of get your juices flowing. I put together a list of 31 Star Wars prompts, mostly characters, a couple of other sort of more general ones. But a few days ago, like about a week ago, it was Palpatine was what I had put on my list. And I did it sort of like not really knowing like, well, when I get there, I'll figure out what I'm going to do. And I decided that I was going to draw like a sexy young Palpatine in the vein of like a Kylo Ren sort of swolo Ren sort of thing. Really drawing heavily on Dark Empire. Because I do like of the comics, I really, really enjoy Dark Empire, which is weird. You'd think I'd like Rise of Skywalker more considering it's basically just copy pasted, but
yeah, pretty much.
So I was going based off of what I envision that story to be and sort of like pulling from that, but giving him the proper lightsabers that he actually has and all that sort of thing. And I colored his hair blonde. Because the Dark Empire comics are very stylized. Like, everything's kind of in these green, blue, purples and some yellows. And I just always, when I was reading that, I always just pictured Palpatine's hair as blonde. But apparently, in canon, Palpatine is a ginger. He's got red hair. And I didn't know this. And I posted this picture on this Discord chat, which I'm totally new to Discord. I don't know like anything about how it really works and like how those communities sort of function, what the nugget is there. So I post this and immediately somebody's like, Palpatine's hair is red. He's a ginger. And I'm like, okay, I was more looking for like a, hey, nice drawing, not really like a, but it's like a couple years ago I did sort of like my little almost like a fanfic drawing of Ezra and Thrawn and a character that I made up, two characters actually, because one was a droid, of what I kind of like envision their continuing story looking like, right? Like off in the unknown regions, wherever they are. And I gave Thrawn a beard. And I was like, yeah, Thrawn looks awesome with a beard. He looks like real.
Everyone dashing, looks better with a beard. Right? Totally. I can't grow one, but I would look a lot better if I had one.
But I was thinking in like that Pierce Brosnan, Grand Admiral Thrawn sort of look. And I was thinking just like that sharp pointed beard sort of thing, giving him like a nice Will Riker. And and immediately like people came out of nowhere and were like, don't you know that Chiss can't grow facial hair? And I was like, no, I didn't know that. That's that's a really dumb piece of Star Wars trivia that you've just given me. I as far as I'm concerned, Chiss can grow facial hair. It's just the one Chiss that we actually know about that's actually part of canon doesn't have a beard. But it drives me nuts because that's how the Star Wars community can be. So
yeah, sometimes you get the real big canon nerds.
Yeah,
which is why I need to catch up though and read the Thrawn Ascendancy, that new book, because that I guess explores the world of the Chiss pretty in depth. And
yeah, it's kind of the first thing to really, really.
A lot of the hyperbole is saying it's like Game of Thrones level deep. I know it's not that deep, but I hear it's pretty exploratory for what we've gotten. So I am pretty stoked to read that at some point.
I just can't do Zahn. I just can't do it. Just can't do it.
He's a little fantastical with his writing.
I hated Thrawn for a long time. I just thought that the character was awful. Although one of my favorite Star Wars characters comes from his books, from the Thrawn trilogy. Gilad Pelion is one of my favorite characters, but Admiral Pelion didn't become one of my favorite characters until New Jedi Order, when he was like, when he took the Imperial Remnant and was like, everybody stop. The Yuuzhan Vong are a bigger threat. We need to ally with the New Republic and stop fighting them. And he was like the voice of reason. I was like, yeah, go for it, Gilad. Like, and he became a hero. He was like the first Imperial that I was like, oh, I get it. Like, some of these guys are actually like, they see themselves as the good guys. They're not all Tarkin. Right. And Vader and Palpatine, right? Like, some of them are actually just
some
like
of them have a moral compass after all.
Yeah, they're just career military men, and like, you know, yeah, like that comes with its own sort of moral quandary. But it's called Star Wars, so you know, let's just go with it. But yeah, but the way that Thrawn was written, I can remember reading. What's the first one? Is it Heir to the Empire? I think it's Heir to the Empire.
Yeah,
the
are you one. Talking about Old Thrawn or New Thrawn?
Old Thrawn.
Old Thrawn's heir.
Yeah, and I reading through it and every time Thrawn like does something quote unquote strategic, it's they're just like, oh yeah, remember that time when he was playing chess with Gilad and it's like, and he was like 10 steps ahead of him. Yeah, he's 10 steps ahead of Luke Skywalker. And you're like, how? He's never met Luke Skywalker. How does he know what Luke Skywalker is going to do? How does he know what Han Solo is going to do? Han Solo doesn't know what Han Solo is going to do.
Right.
That's kind of the point. And so, like, I think I made it about halfway through Air and was like, nah, I'm done. I can't, because I just hate that Deus Ex Machina bad guy of, like, like, he just, like, that has... He has all of the knowledge that the author has, right? And because it almost it's almost a fanfic sort of thing of like a self insert element of,
or
like,
it's like, if I was the bad guy, this is who he would be.
Yeah, and the thing that's crazy about it is that like it's not a bad idea for a villain to be able to be 10 steps ahead of everybody at all times. It's what makes Palpatine such a great villain. But Palpatine has the benefit of an in-universe explanation for how he can be. And it's also the fulcrum, pun intended, I guess, that on which his story turns in Return of the Jedi, where it's like he thinks he's always been 10 steps ahead, but the one thing that he couldn't account for was the one thing he's never understood, which is love, right? Like, it was Vader's love for his son, Anakin's love for his son. So it's like you establish that Palpatine has this foresight, because the point is that you're going to pull that rug out from under him. And it's like, as much as he thinks, you know, he can see into the future, we go back to what Yoda says in Empire, it's always in motion is the future, right? So there's like, you're playing with the themes with that. With Thrawn, I always found that people love him because he's a bad guy who is always, you know, a few steps ahead. And I never, like I said, I never finished those books. So I'm sure that he gets his comeuppance in the end and all that sort of thing. But it wasn't until Rebels that that a room full of very skilled writers put a little bit more thought into Grand Admiral Thrawn. And we're like sitting in his office and seeing the art on the walls and stuff, and he's actually studying the characters,
right?
And because he's coming in season three, it's like we actually know these characters really well, and we're discovering things about them as he does. And so it's like, you're like, it's serving a purpose within the story. It's not just him being able to go, I know where you're going to be before you're going to be there, and that's why I'm going to put these interdictor cruisers there, right? It's like, like he actually, like, you see it. You see the thought process.
Right.
And so it's at that point that I'm like, okay, that's cool. Like, that is, so he became a favorite character, not a favorite character, but a character that I appreciate throughout the course of Star Wars Rebels.
Yeah.
I tried to read one of the, or not read, I listened to the audiobooks, but to do one of the what was it? I think it was Allegiance, the one that's that he's teamed up with Anakin. It takes place during the Clone Wars and yeah. And in, I think in between A New Hope and Empire, or some, or maybe it's right before.
It's like right before Rebels.
Oh yeah,
The third book like leads up.
Yeah,
to
I guess it can't.
His final episodes of Rebels.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
Yeah, and and so you've got the story of like he's working with Anakin in the past, and then he's mm-hmm. working with Vader in the future, and you get like you slowly get the idea that like, oh, Thrawn's figured it out. Thrawn is right. one of the only people who knows that Anakin is Vader, and he,
right.
he kind of like never really tips his hand. I don't know, maybe he does at the end. I never finished that one either. But case in point, it was very like, I get it. Can we get to the story? Can we stop talking about like these people in this factory and get to like what's actually happening in this plot? Cause
yeah, there's just like, so much. That's like a big meandering. Problem with like fantasy and science fiction writers is sometimes they can just get so wordy.
Yeah.
It's like you almost have to be in a certain mindset just to want to read about it.
Yeah, like they get so into their own idea or world building that you're like, that's why.
And I get it, though. That's like that's their world. That's their bread and butter. So totally. I get why they're setting it up so
and
much.
And so many people, that's what they come to something like Star Wars for.
Right.
But like my favorite Star Wars novels are the Brian Daley Han Solo Adventures, which is some of the earliest mm-hmm. Star Wars stuff there is.
Yeah.
And I still feel like it's never really been done that well. Because those stories, it's like, yeah, there's world building in it that's incidental, that's part of the plot. But the stories are really about the characters, and it's really mm-hmm. about like the forward momentum of the action, which to me, like that's what Star Wars is, right? Like we're always right. constantly moving. Right.
I'm still trying to find a new book that writes Han as well as that trilogy did.
Yeah.
Like the closest I think I've gotten so far was I read Most Wanted, that came out, that Ray Carson wrote, it yeah. came out to tie into the Solo movie.
Yeah.
And I read it before seeing the movie. And that book is fantastic. I think it's probably the one I recommend all the time about new canon. Cause it's so underappreciated. Cause
yeah.
like, she nailed Han in that book.
Last Shot is also, I think, really, really good. Although mm-hmm. like you're jumping around between all the time periods. So
yeah.
it's got kind of a different vibe.
Yeah.
And you spend a lot of time with Lando. Cause I really find like there's some good Han stuff in there, but I find that story is really about Lando.
It's a Lando story, yeah.
But yeah, I found that Han was written really well in that as well. But I haven't read Most Wanted, so I'll have to check that out.
Yeah, that's very good.
Like those Brian Daley, like that's why I love Solo so much, because Solo is just one of those books.
Mm-hmm.
It's but the great thing
it's,
about it
even
is
got all those Easter eggs from it too.
It isn't one of those books, but if you told me, oh, this is adapted from one that never got published, I'd be mm-hmm. like, yep, nope, yep, that makes sense. That totally
right.
that totally jives. It has the same sort of like pace and humor and it's got the same Han.
In the Star Wars Celebration in Chicago in 2019, I think I met your doppelganger in line to get Sam Witwer's autograph, because there was a guy that was next to me in line when we were waiting, and he was talking about how Solo was his all-time favorite Star Wars film because it was like an adaptation of those books, and he was just going into such great detail on it. And I was just thinking, I was like, I read those when I was a child. I still have them.
Yeah.
But I haven't reread them since. And I was like, how do you remember those so specifically? It's like, that's impressive, man.
they're also adapted into comics. So, like, that's a because they were newspaper strip comics, I think. I don't know if all three of them got adapted eventually. But I know that Star's End definitely did. I love the adventure vibe of it, right? And mm-hmm. I find like that's why I think I gravitate to Rebels so much as well, because Rebels has a lot of that same DNA, that very like pulp adventure, week to week serial feel to it.
That's when I think Star Wars is its strongest to me. Yeah. Like I always say, I like my Star Wars to be fun. which is why out of the movies I like more than the others, it almost just boils down to the ones that I'm like having the most fun with while I watch them.
I think that's one of the biggest things that the sequel trilogy, and I think especially Rogue One, just completely blow past in a lot of ways. Like there is some fun stuff in The Force Awakens and Last Jedi, and the first third of Rise of Skywalker is very fun. And that's the part of Rise of Skywalker that I really like. Like everything up until she blows up the Chewbacca ship, right? Like think that she's killed Chewie. Like everything up until that point, it's like, oh, we're on a fun adventure with these characters. Finally, at last, all three of them together. Chewie's there, BBA. It would have been nice if R2 was there, but with 3PO and everything. And some of 3PO's best moments in the entire saga are on Passana. Like the moment where they all turn to look at him because he said something incredulous and something like ridiculous. It's like, oh yes, quite lucky indeed or whatever.
Yeah.
And they all turn to look at him and there's like a beat and then he turns and looks behind him. Like, what are we looking at? It's so, and then when they get sucked into the sinking sands and Poe is like, Finn, Rey. And he's like, oh, you didn't say my name, but I'm also okay. You're like, man, 3PO, you're so good. But then that movie gets so bogged down in the Rey Palpatine aspect of it.
It really tries to do a lot in something that was a closing, which kind of stinks. I love the Sith world building they were doing there at the end, but I don't know when we're going to ever get that expanded on. Like, I don't know if it'll have to be a book. I don't care if it's a book, TV show, whatever. Yeah. I just want to know more about that. Because they threw all that in at the end. And it's like, this is some good stuff. I want more of that.
It's the sort of stuff that you're like, wow, if you guys knew you were going to do this in the third movie, maybe you could have planted some of this in the last two.
Right.
But yeah, like I feel very heavily that Rise of Skywalker is trying to compensate for a lot of The Last Jedi, even though it's not necessary, right? Like it's unnecessarily going back and retconning and rewriting stuff. And as much as J.J. Abrams and Chris Terrio and others are like, no, we didn't do that at all. It's like, you did. The moment with Luke and the lightsaber is absolutely it's pandering to the fanboys who are like, Luke Skywalker would never throw away a lightsaber. It's like, I'm sorry, that thing's the Youngling Killer 3000. It's got some bad vibes attached to it. I would love a story about Luke where he's, and I don't know, maybe we'll get this in the comics or something, because right now he's in that stage where like he's lost that lightsaber and he's found another one. I'm not current on those. It's because I read on the Marvel Unlimited app, so I'm always 6 months behind.
Right.
But I know he's got like the High Republic era lightsaber, the gold one right now, and obviously eventually he'll build his green one. I would love a story, like maybe a Return of the Jedi certain point of view, where you
we'll
could,
get
like,
that.
Yeah, where you could like talk about him building his lightsaber and him going like, it feels so different in my hand. To that, like is sort of in his voice is like, my father's lightsaber was always so heavy, like it carried the burdens of, like implying that the things that were done with that lightsaber were carried with it,
right?
And like when Rey picks it up at the beginning of The Force Awakens, yeah, she's tapping into Luke's story, but somewhere underneath that, there's also everything that Anakin did with that lightsaber, and obviously some very bad stuff happened.
Right.
So Luke putting his hands back on that lightsaber again after decades of it being gone from his life, and from him turning his back on the Jedi entirely, it's like to touch that lightsaber again would be inviting back in all of those feelings. So it's like, of course he would toss it behind him and be like, I want nothing to do with this. I want nothing to do with the Jedi. I want nothing to do with the galaxy.
Yeah, like, which is, I think is always funny though. It's like, I don't like The Last Jedi as much as like most people, but I love Luke's story.
Yeah.
But that's just because Luke is the OG. You can't beat him.
And that's, like, to me, that's the crux of people who like The Last Jedi and people who don't. The people who don't have a preconceived notion of who Luke Skywalker is that doesn't mesh with that story.
Right. They wanted the action figure moment.
Yeah.
Where he's running around, killing everyone with his lightsaber, saving the day. But, like, we got, like, a complex moral story.
Yeah.
About his journey instead. Well, so, I mean, he still fought the battle.
Yeah.
Just on a different playing field. He fought it mentally, not physically.
Well, and exactly in the same way that Obi-Wan does. And can you imagine if the prequels had come out first and you had all of these stories of Obi-Wan Kenobi going out and being the Jedi that I think everybody wants to see Luke Skywalker be, right? Anakin and Obi-Wan have those adventures in the Clone Wars 100%. And then you come into A New Hope, like, let's say there's a 20-year gap in there, and then you tell the story in A New Hope, and he's like, I don't like to fight.
Right.
I don't want to do that anymore. And all you get to see him do in that movie is slice a guy's arm off and then die at the hands of Darth Vader, right? In a very weak lightsaber. I love that lightsaber battle, but like in a very, like, slow-paced...
I mean, it is fair to call it weak. Like, it's very easy to understand the style of that kind of fighting. It was very samurai film based and stuff, but that happened over 40 years ago now. Yeah. Like, we've had so many different iterations of how to make that speed up a little bit.
The lightsabers had extension cords on them at the time. Like, it was a whole different thing. But, it's so funny how people can go, like, Obi-Wan Kenobi's story is so great, and the way that, you know, he becomes the mentor and then sacrifices himself. And it's like, that's exactly the same story that they put Luke on.
Right.
It was just like his tragedy was just a different tragedy. His failure was a different failure, right?
Mm-hmm.
But the broad strokes are all exactly the same. So it's funny because you'll hear people say that The Force Awakens is a carbon copy, but you'll never hear people say, you'll only hear people talk about how subversive The Last Jedi is. And it's like subversive, like, no, it follows all of the rules of Star Wars, like 100%.
Right.
It expands and brings in Force Skyping and stuff like that, but
like, that's a cool new addition, though.
Yeah, absolutely.
Like, it's still bringing something fresh.
Yeah.
And like, I still think that The Last Jedi is the most akin, like, that's more of an evolution of the tone that the prequel films had than The Force Awakens was.
Yeah. Yeah, I've said that a lot as well, that The Last Jedi, to me, The Last Jedi accounts for everything.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's the first Star Wars movie to really, like bring the whole thing together. Like, when we get to Canto Bight, it's like Canto Bight is just straight lifted out of the prequels. And it shows you that Rian Johnson had an appreciation for those movies as well.
Right.
That I don't think that J.J. Abrams... And I don't think that Colin Trevorrow would have had. I don't think that Gareth Edwards had that. I don't think that even with Solo, there's not as much of that. Although, like, there are references, but it's not like there isn't as much tonal stuff as there is in The Last Jedi, where it's like Rian Johnson very clearly watched all six movies closely, not just the three that he grew up with,
right?
And then, in my opinion, Colin Trevorrow just went like, yeah, I've seen Star Wars, I can write a Star War. And he just started writing a movie.
Yeah, well,
and
didn't well really... now he's trying to have his swan son with Jurassic World 3, so I mean, have at it.
Yeah. the sequels, I think the biggest thing is that they're just discordant, right? It's you have three movies with three very different tones, and unfortunately the characters have to be along for that ride, and so it's really hard to vibe with any one character for too long because you're like, wait, now they're behaving in a different way. Like, it's...
I would have loved to, once they figure out time travel or parallel universe travel, I want to go to the universe where The Last Jedi was not divisive.
Yeah.
I want to see what the third movie plan is in the world where that was as universally loved as the critics and Lucasfilm thought it was going to be.
Yeah.
Because they were so confident with that before that movie even released, they gave Rian Johnson a trilogy.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like when that was announced, I was like, they have so much faith in The Last Jedi and that it's going to, and they had that, the director in the Jedi documentary, that's a special feature. That is a very brutal and honest and raw documentary that they would not have released had they known what the backlash would have been.
And
because Mark Hamill several times throughout that documentary is just like, I don't like this choice, but he's the director and I'm going to do it.
Yeah. But the great thing about that documentary and it's like, it's probably, other than like the original trilogy documentaries that I've watched time and time again, Director in the Jedi is one of the ones that I love to go back to, because it is that evolution of Mark coming in, being excited, being a little bit crestfallen, and then you get to that point where Yoda shows up. And it all and somehow
you see the emotion hit.
Being back on that set with Frank Oz and with that Yoda puppet, everything clicks into place for him. And to me, it's like, for the movie, it's the same thing. It's like, to me, when you get to that moment with Yoda, all of a sudden Luke's journey clicks. It clicks for the character. It clicks for the audience. It's just like,
goosebumps even thinking about that scene.
We're so upset seeing Luke do these things. He's almost an antagonist in a way. He certainly is to Rey, right? Which is one of the reasons why it's so weird the way that they talk to each other in Rise of Skywalker, where it's like, you guys were never really chummy. Like, this friendly, jovial conversation is now weird. But it's like you get to see that evolution of Mark Hamill coming to terms with the story and then finally clicking and understanding, oh, that's what we're doing. Mm-hmm. Because he's in for 40 years or almost 40 years had this idea of what it would be like to return to that role, because he had the conversation with George of what that would be. Mm-hmm. And then it ended up being something different. And so just like the fans, he had to adjust to that. But I think the biggest thing is that Lucasfilm could not have predicted that Russia would decide to use social media as a way to cause division in the United States, in North America, really. And that one of the things that they would target in order to do that would be Star Wars. Because there's an actual published paper that
I used that in a paper I wrote. I wrote like a 15-page paper about all of that fallout.
Yeah.
So like that was such a fascinating study to read. And
It's incredible that there are, because there are still so many people, no different than politics right now, that are still going about their lives thinking that the conversation from the last really 8 years hasn't been conducted, really like composed by like essentially the KGB, right? Like, that's just like, that's like pulling strings, getting Americans to hate each other over stupid stuff. Like, not that Star Wars is stupid, but trivial things like a space movie about about wizards and dogs that fly spaceships, right?
I think time will be kind to The Last Jedi and The Force Awakens. I really don't know yet what time will say with The Rise of Skywalker, because that's such a cocktail of so many different so many different ideas. I think out of all the new movies, I know you're already a big fan, and I am too, but I think Solo will be the one that's going to end up becoming the
overall
favorite.
Yeah,
that ages the best.
Solo will be the movie that everybody talks about in 20 years and go like, why didn't they make more of that stuff?
Right.
Like, what happened? And like, and old timers like us will be like, oh, well, let me tell you a story.
Yeah, let me go into
Phil Lord and Chris Miller and Ron Howard and
that movie. The Last even got Jedi. Gypped, that movie even got gypped by Avengers toy sales. They couldn't even have advertising for the movie. Because I think it's not even that old yet, and I think Rogue One is already starting to show its age for me.
Yeah, Rogue One is it's no secret to people who listen to the podcast. Rogue One's like one of my least favorite Star Wars movies. Although Rise of Skywalker has done a lot to make Rogue One more tolerable for me, but Rogue One, it's got that it's the It's the Act 3 turn where it's like, I know for most people going into Act 3, like that's when they get really excited in that movie.
That's when I like it. Once they get to Scarif, then I'm in.
I love everything that happens on Scarif, but I hate the transition because everything that led up to that point was like this dark, interesting story about Jyn Erso, who is like, she's not really part of the rebellion, but she is a rebel, and she saw Guerrera and all of that stuff, tying back into the Clone Wars, tying back into to like the rise of the Empire, all of that stuff. It's like, okay, there's some meat on these bones. Let's dig into this. And then she gets to the to that moment where she's addressing the whole thing, and all of a sudden she's Princess Leia. She starts talking like she's Princess Leia, of like, rebellions are built on hope. And it's like, who the hell are you, lady? You're not the character that we've been dealing with for the last hour and a half of this movie. And then the last half hour of the movie is like, well, who cares what her motivations are? Everything that's happening now is awesome.
Yeah, like, and have you seen these space battles going on right now? It's awesome.
The space battle over at Scarif, I think, is quickly cementing itself, especially in the wake of Rise of Skywalker, as I think the best space battle in the films. Because I think in the same way that, like, we talk about Solo learning from all of the other Star Wars and really like doing the best Star Wars adventure that it possibly can, all the good stuff, none of the bad stuff sort of thing.
Yeah.
The battle over Scarif, it learns from every other piece of Star Wars that came before it. It's got all of the awesome elements from A New Hope, from Empire, from Jedi, from the prequels, even from The Force Awakens. Like, it's, and it's using the most modern technology that they had to accomplish the best space battle that I think that we've seen. And when I think about, like, it's Return of the Jedi, it's the Battle of Endor, and it's the Battle of Scarif. It's those two that it's like, no, you guys, you've got it nailed. Clean lines, clear objectives, awesome chatter between the pilots.
Yeah.
And
I mean, I think about Mastan the Space Monkey every day.
Yeah.
So, like, that character is only in it for 10 seconds, and I love that character to death.
Totally.
So I like to say that since we don't get to see his body and his ship after it crashes, he's still alive somewhere, and we'll see him again. But
he somehow his U-wing goes down in the water right before the Death Star blows up Scarif, and it's like, so he somehow escapes certain death.
If they can bring Palpatine back, they can bring back Bastan the Space Monkey just for me.
Somehow, Bastan has returned. Absolutely. If anything will get Oscar Isaac to reprise his role as Poe Dameron, that'll be the moment, just to come in and say that line.
Yeah,
100%.
I'll just write it myself. That way it'll have to happen.
Totally. Cool. So, yeah, talking about space battles, let's segue over to Star Wars Squadrons, which released at the beginning of the month, and I was very anticipated, heavily anticipated by a lot of folks. How have you been finding Squadron so far?
I really liked it. I finished the story, I think like last weekend now at this point. I haven't tried the multiplayer yet because everyone said it's super competitive and I'm not that good at flight sim games. So I probably will try it at some point, but I haven't decided when. But like, I really enjoyed the story though. I thought it was a lot of fun. I liked the characters. I know you said you haven't finished the story yet. So,
I haven't finished the story
yet. Yeah, so I won't go too far into story details, but I did like it. I like all the characters that they introduce. I always tend to go more like Republic than Imperial, though. So, because you kind of bounce between both worlds in the campaign, but I always like the Republic side a little bit more. I don't know what it is about the Imperials. I just can't get myself to sympathize for them the way that they want me to.
I've only played like the because it kind of, you say, it flips back and forth. So I've played the first chunk as the Republic, and then and then you switch over. I think you play like two or three missions as the Imperials, and then you switch back to the Republic pretty quick. And I'm still on that second segment as the Republic, so I haven't played a ton of Imperial stuff yet. But yeah, instantly I'm like, I care much less about these characters than I do about the Republic characters.
Yeah.
But I think it was such a mistake for them to make your character in the story not a character, right?
Yeah. Like, I think that was like a side effect, basically, of making it so VR friendly.
Yeah.
Because, like, the whole navigating at the game, like, when you're not in the cockpit, is just very VR-focused.
Totally.
Like, you can just tell it would be the best way to play that game is through a VR headset, yeah. Which I don't have.
neither do I. So, I'll tell you, like, this is the thing that has slowed me down on progressing through it, is exactly that element of it. Mm-hmm. I would have much preferred... So, here, by contrast... because the gameplay in Squadrons, I think, is fantastic. I think it's...
I agree.
It's not exactly what I want. I just want Rogue Squadron again. I want arcade. I don't want Flight Sim.
Yeah.
But it's still good. It's definitely light years beyond Battlefront.
Which was my fear, was it was going to be like Battlefront 2's Flight, which is just awful all around.
Yeah, even with tuning, I never got Battlefront to fly the way that I wanted it to.
Mm-hmm.
And with very minimal tuning, I got Squadrons to fly the way that I wanted it to with the controller.
They really nailed the balance of, like, it's Flight Simmy, but it's... approachable enough where you can make it work if it's not your thing, but you can also get super deep if you want.
I'll tell you, like, the biggest thing that I always still want is, like, I hate this move towards the throttle being on one of the sticks, especially mm-hmm. the throttle being on the same stick as either, because you can flip it around. I have my throttle on the same one as roll. And it drives me nuts because it means that I'm constantly throttling up and down when I don't want to be.
Right.
Like that, it needs to be in a separate spot. Right.
Yeah.
And on a flight stick, you would have your own throttle, right? You could have a separate throttle.
That Which would be another better. Probably better way of playing that game than just a controller.
Because you could set it and forget it sort of thing. Or, like, you know, like, when I need to punch it, I can punch it. Otherwise, I'll leave it in the center, which is where I usually want it. And occasionally, I want to slow down. Very rarely do I want to slow down. I would have much preferred it being on the bottom triggers, right? On the analog triggers, like it is in Rogue Squadron 2 and on the GameCube, where it's like, if I press it down all the way, I boost.
Yeah.
Right? Because the GameCube had that awesome analog trigger where you could press down, 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 and then it would click.
Yeah.
And the click would be like, yeah, let's go.
Yeah.
And it had a nice visceral feeling. And I feel like... switching all my systems to engines and then punching it is definitely it does have the right feel, but it's not as instant as I want it to be.
Mm-hmm.
Which in VR with a flight stick, I guarantee would be a different story, because it'd be like flick, 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 and then push it forward. And now I'm going as fast as I can and really feeling that speed from inside the cockpit.
Right.
But on a controller, it just doesn't work. And then having it mixed in with either your steering or your roll, it just, like, it, that doesn't work for me as well as I want it to. But that said, like, it controls incredibly well,
mm-hmm.
As opposed to Battlefront, which I suffered through the gameplay in Battlefront, both the space stuff and the, like, in all the story mode stuff. I just, like, I gritted my teeth and I just got through it as best as I could. I turned that thing down to easy.
Yep, which is what I thought I was going to have to do for this one. Yeah, was just kind of grin and bear it and power through for the story. But totally. I ended up having a lot of fun playing it, so that made it actually worth it.
But the story in Battlefront 2 is so good. Like, I love that story. I love Iden Versio. All of those characters are so great, to the point where it's like, I want them to show up in other stuff, right? Like you want those characters to have a life beyond that video game.
Yeah.
I would have much preferred an experience where I am in a mission, I am in a cutscene. I am in a mission, I am in a cutscene. The stop, I'm standing in the hangar, I have to mouse over this guy and listen to him just talk at me.
Yeah.
And then
they just keep going sometimes. They have like four different conversations in a row with you and you're just like, okay.
Yeah, you could tell that it was like this game changed in its production life cycle. Like it was one thing and then it turned into another thing. And I think I very, very much think that this was meant to be like a 4-hour VR experience with just the story stuff. Mm-hmm. And then somebody saw it and went, you need to make this work on everything, and we need to put multiplayer in it, because how can we do this without multiplayer?
Right.
And so I think that the game took on a life of its own after that point.
I'm glad it did, though.
And like it's good. My thing is that like Squadrons 2 is gonna be awesome.
Yeah.
Right. Squadrons is a great game, and I think like it's not like a contender for game of the year or anything, but it is definitely like a standout Star Wars game.
I don't think this kind of game would ever be game of the year contender, though, because like even if they leaned super flight sim in it, like a flight sim game is such a niche genre. Yeah. Like even with Star Wars attached to it, you're still not going to get everybody on there playing it. Like, I guess like the most approachable Star Wars game would be like Lego Star Wars. Like, like that's going to get a much more broader player base than Squadrons will.
Totally.
But for $40, this thing is absolutely loaded with content. The campaign is a perfect length for it. There's a multiplayer facet to it. The graphics are beautiful. The game controls well, and it's got flight stick options and VR options. Like a lot of people were trying to raise a stink when the devs were like, "Yeah, we don't plan on doing any DLC with this. That you just kind of get what you pay for," and you do. You get the full 40 out of it by the time this is done. And I haven't even touched the multiplayer yet, and I think it is. But I have at least glanced at the menus and stuff, and like see the customization that gets involved, and I've watched some live streams of like knickknacks you can put around your cockpit and stuff, and the framework is there now where they could really release a Squadrons every October at $40 a pop and have it be a different era of Star Wars each time, or even continue this story forward. And like, this could be like their Madden for Star Wars, basically.
Yeah, or which, like a Battlefield or Call of Duty sort of thing.
Which could let those games breathe more and give them more dev time so they don't have to push those things out.
Yeah.
Because like the same, it's such a compact, packaged thing that, just everything's in there. You don't got to worry about anything else. They can be using any resource they have now on what's next.
Yeah, I mean, I think the interesting part of that is that it's so many things are games of service now, right? Mm-hmm. And it feels like this would work as games of service, but it's also kind of like, to your point, it's like, it like kind of thank God that it's not. Thank God that it's just kind of like you get what you get.
And it is
like that self-contained sort of thing, but at the same time it is very like, well, there's no B-wing in it.
Yeah, right? Stuff like that. But I think EA learned, deservingly so, they got so much flack for the Battlefront 2 launch, which they've turned around. I do give them credit for sticking to that game and completely reversing course.
Yeah.
And now Battlefront 2 Online is awesome. But I think EA learned from that, because that didn't just have some gamers upset. It had everyone upset. Yeah. But I don't think they would pull something like that again.
It's almost an overcorrection at this point, right? Because it's like Jedi Fallen Order is a really great example of, I would gladly give you another $30 for more story.
For like an expansion.
For a DLC story pack or something like that. I would gladly give you $5 for a new outfit and some new saber parts.
Yeah.
Right? Like, because I love that game, I have played through it 3 times. And in the modern era of gaming, I don't do that. Because there's a new game every 3 months that has to be played, right?
Right. And, but, like, it puts, like, pressure on you, too, to even play it like that. Because, that's what I, like, with Squadrons, it's like, do I really want to dip my toe into multiplayer? Because, like, Cyberpunk's out in, like, just a few weeks.
Yeah, we got, like, Miles Morales and Cyberpunk are right on the horizon.
Right.
And you got your PS5 pre-ordered, or?
I went Xbox Series X.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I think this is one of the places where we differ, where we have different opinions. Yeah, because I got that PS5 pre-ordered. I cannot wait for Spider-Man.
Well, I mean, I can get that on my PS4, so that's fine.
That's true.
Yeah.
But I just got the 4K 65-inch TV, so yeah. in prep for the PS5. So I am so excited because I have a launch PS4. So
oh wow, you kept that going the whole time, huh?
It still runs.
Eventually switched it out for the Slim.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I never swapped out. I had a launch PS3 as well that I didn't swap out until after the PS4 was out.
Wow.
For a Slim. And yeah. Then I sold off the launch PS3 because it was... I had to get the thermal paste on that thing.
Oh, okay.
I replaced. I had to get the power source replaced. But it was like... That thing sounded like... You talk about the PlayStation jet engine. That thing sounded like a whole hangar. by the time that I got rid of it and then got the Slim, and I'm like, oh, this would be really great if the top of it was thicker and you couldn't hear the drive going meep 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 meep.
Yeah.
It sounds like a Star Wars droid.
Yeah, it does.
It drives me nuts, but I can't wait for the PS5 and the high def. It'll be my first experience with it. And Spider-Man was the first game that I platinumed. And then Fallen Order was the second. And then I, what else? I just platinumed something else. I don't remember what it was, but, man, something over the summer. What came out over the summer? Man, that's going to bug me. But I only have 3 platinums. Even though I have, hours and hours and hours logged on my PlayStation. I'm very excited for that. And to even just see Squadrons upgraded, like not upgraded formally, but just like running better.
Yeah.
Because it can chop a little bit.
Right.
But I expect that it's going to be.
Like that game has such a good like engine to it. Like, this is the dorkiest thing you'll ever hear, I swear. But, like, every time the mission would require you to kick it into hyperspace, I would have my Alexa play Danger Zone.
Nice. That's perfect.
It just fit the vibe so well every time.
Ghost of Tsushima. That's what it was. That was the other thing that I platinumed.
Okay.
And that was like, by accident. I just stumbled upon it. For a long time, until I platinum Spider-Man, I actually considered it a point of pride that I don't remember what level I was at before they switched things, but I'm out now at 309 is my trophy level.
I forgot they changed that.
Yeah,
that whole thing.
I think I was at like a 15 or a 16 or something like that. And I was always like, I always had like this point of pride that like, I have a very, very respectable PlayStation trophy level, considering I don't have a single platinum, right? Because platinums are worth a lot of points or whatever, however you look at it. Because I just like I've played so much of so many games, but I've never been like a completionist. But then Spider-Man was so good.
That game was awesome.
I just like lived inside that game for so long, and I kept going back to it. And then by the time that the DLC was all out and I had completed all the DLC, it was like, I only have like 3 trophies left to get in the main game. And so I just went in and I actually did them. And then with Fallen Order, yeah, I was like 2 trophies off. So I was like, okay, let's do it. And then with Ghost of Tsushima, I finished the story. But I had done, I did everything. I cleared the whole map first. And that before I finished the story, because I was having so much fun with that game.
Yeah.
And then I looked and I was like, I'm 2 trophies away. I am, and they're easy trophies. I'm just going to go get them. It was like kicking a guy and doing something else. And I was like, yeah, no, easy peasy. So
that's awesome.
I don't know. Maybe they're just making platinums easier nowadays, but
that could be. I don't have any platinums, but
no.
I don't really chase after achievements and stuff like that, though.
And that's the thing is that neither did I. But then there's, it's like the other games that I've always been close with are like the Tomb Raider games and like Assassin's Creed games, I'll get a lot of trophies, but mm-hmm. never all of, like, nowhere near all of them, right?
Yeah.
Because Assassin's Creed games, it's like, go find 300 feathers. It's like, I'm actually not going to do that.
I don't want to do any of that.
Yeah, that actually sounds like it's not fun.
That's an errand. That's not an achievement. Yeah.
But it's funny because this stems all the way back to, now we're just talking about games in general, but
right.
this stems back to the X-Men Origins Wolverine tie-in, the one by Raven.
Yeah.
That is like X-Men Origins Wolverine is a bad movie. You'll never get any argument from me on that. The video game is so good.
I've heard that.
It drives me nuts.
I never played it though.
That they didn't make more of them. It's so good. Or at least it was at the time. It's a brawler. It probably doesn't hold up. But the reason why I didn't go after Platinums is because I got so close on that game and one of the trophies broke.
Oh.
And so it was like you have to delete your save and play the game again. Like you have to start from scratch in order right. to do this. And I was like, and that's a game where you're like unlocking costumes and mm-hmm. comic book covers and blah, blah. And I was like, nope, can't do it.
Yeah.
Can't do it. And I got rid of the game and was like, that's fine. I'll just be a guy who has no platinums. I'm just never doing this again. And until Spider-Man, it's funny that it was a Marvel game that turned me off of it. And then a Marvel game that
brought it back
that
for
brought
you.
It back. But
yeah.
Yeah. What are your feelings on Fallen Order?
I love Fallen Order. That was a game as well, kind of like Squadrons with Flight Sims. It's like, I'm terrible at Soulsborne games.
Yeah.
Like, really bad at them. Yeah. So that these controls for Fallen Order being basically like Dark Souls Lite is perfect for me. Because it's like, well, this game could just be my Dark Souls then. I can learn that kind of combat for this game, which is Star Wars, which works out way better for me anyway.
Yeah.
Because I tried playing, I think it was like Dark Souls 3 I bought when that came out. And like my brother is like pro good at those games. Mm. And he would like come over and even try and like coach me from my couch on what to do. And I would die and he'd just be like, yeah, I got nothing for you. And I'd be like, okay. So like I loved the combat of Fallen Order. I thought it was fun. Loved the story.
Yeah.
And everything about it. I love Cal as a character, and I can't wait to see what that sequel is going to end up being. But there were so many like callbacks in that throughout that campaign, even to like the Clone Wars series, like mm-hmm. that whole entire mission when you're in Ilum, like I was like trying not to ugly cry. I was just like so happy and excited and like, every time he would mention something, he'd be like, I remember that being in the episode when the younglings go. And then, so, like, I loved everything about, like, that was fan service done right in that campaign.
Totally.
And it really brought me back. I think that's probably my favorite EA Star Wars game so far is Fallen Order. So that's probably the one I'm most anticipating from them next, like, more than a Battlefront 3 or Squadrons 2 is give me totally. Whatever the next Star Wars Jedi game is.
Yeah, absolutely. We've talked about it a lot on the podcast with different guests. Fallen Order is it was my favorite piece of Star Wars content from 2019, hands down.
Yeah.
It blew everything else out of the water. Those characters, I went into it, that was another game where I was like, or another Star Wars thing where I was like kind of lukewarm on it. I was like, whatever. They're rushing this out. I'm kind of pissed that this isn't the Amy Hennig game, right? Because mm-hmm. I'm a huge Uncharted fan. That's one of my favorite game series. So I was down for that. And then EA canceled it. And we never really got the story behind that. And
right.
It was like, this is kind of nonsense. And it kind of pissed me off. And then the lead up to it was like, well, I'm going to play it. I'm definitely mm-hmm. going to play it. But I think I can probably wait. And then, and this is fine. It's perfect to have you on because Greg Miller got his hands on it and was like, this is awesome. And now I'm a Star Wars fan. And I was like, hold up. Greg, I hate space Miller is like, I'm a Star Wars fan now. And he went like full bore.
Yeah.
Like, to the point of, like, buying cosplay stuff. And, like, he went real hard Star Wars. in the latter half of 2019. And then unfortunately Rise of Skywalker happened, and I think that it kind of put the wet blanket back on top of Star Wars for him. Right. He's not really tooting that horn anymore. But I get it, because like I got into that game and it was like within the first 15 minutes of it. That's a lie. Within the first 5 minutes of that game, that song, the song by The Who,
I can't remember what the title of it is.
I think it's like Sugan Isana or something like that. Yeah. It's Star Wars. You open with that music, and it pulls in, and then it's like him listening basically on his Star Wars Discman. Mm-hmm. And I was like, oh, I'm in. I'm 100% in on this. And then you get to Seer and Grease, and eventually Grease says the phrase in the game, "Greasy money, baby." And I was like, this might be one of the best Star Wars stories ever told. I don't know what to tell you. But like, it was just, it's got everything, because you've got a Jedi, you've got a cool alien party member, you've got a great new droid, you've got awesome bad guys, the whole thing just top to bottom is so good. And then the end of the game, like from the point that Marin joins you and then you finish off the story, it's just like some of the best Star Wars storytelling. Mm-hmm. And I mean, like, spoilers if you haven't beaten Jedi Fallen Order yet, but although they spoiled it with some of the marketing, when Vader shows up at the very end, it's just like, come on. It's
such a great moment.
So good. Because we haven't seen hide nor hair of him throughout the entire thing.
Uh-huh.
It's just like the Empire. I think there's maybe one mention of Vader previous to that. And then he shows up, and you're just like, well, I have to run away now.
Yep.
I'm not even going to try and fight him.
That's all you can do is just run.
I'm not even going to try. And you just run from him, and he's just like destroying this entire building. And to me, it kind of almost explains why there aren't Inquisitors in the original trilogy, because of what happens in that game. And then Vader, I mean, Cal does a pretty good number on the Inquisitor headquarters, right, as well.
Yeah.
But Vader basically destroys it trying to kill you and Seer, and so it's like, well, that's the end of the Inquisitors, I guess. It's just whichever ones are still left, which we see in Star Wars Rebels. But
right,
yeah, my hope, hey, there's one of those trains, I heard it.
Yep.
My hope, and I've said this before on the podcast, is that the sequel, we will maybe like start as Cal with all of your powers and everything, and then we'll switch over to Marin, who, ooh, he'll be training.
Yeah.
And so you'll go back, because you gotta, in every game, you gotta figure out like how do we depower so that you can collect these abilities again.
Right.
So Marin will start with her own set of Night Sister abilities that we didn't have before, but she won't have push, she won't have pull, she won't have the standard Jedi, mm-hmm, tools, and most importantly, she won't start with a lightsaber, right?
Yeah.
Cal starts with obviously his master's lightsaber, even though he'd already built one before that, but then you build it up over the course. It would be really cool if that started right from the ground up, mm-hmm, to the point where you have to build the lightsaber from the beginning. And if they could almost make it a game mechanic of like, this is how a lightsaber works, and you actually have to collect the pieces,
yeah,
the functional pieces, not just aesthetics, but to make that a big part of the story, that Marin is on this path, on her, in like sort of her redemption story, not that she really needs to be redeemed, but just sort of like on this path towards the light, to becoming a hero. And that's symbolized by her building her lightsaber.
Oh, yeah.
I think it would be really,
that would
really
be cool, a good way of telling it.
Yeah.
I always kind of wondered if maybe they'll expand into, like, more RPG elements in the sequel, mm, than what this one has. Because, like, they kind of got a basic framework to make, like, a multi-party planet-hopping RPG in a way. Kind of like akin to how Zelda is. A lot of people consider Zelda to be RPG. Some people just consider it to be an action adventure. Like, you could kind of go that same route with this, where it's, like, a little bit larger scale, a little bit deeper RPG mechanics being borrowed in. That would give some depth that way, too. Like, those are just, like, simple ways that could evolve that gameplay further.
I could see some Breath of the Wild stuff really expanding the gameplay of Fallen Order and giving it, because the exploration is fun, but it is very much like it's linear paths with its branching linear paths, right? Like it's got a little bit of the Metroidvania element of like revisit these places, check out
it's like every things. Time you land on a planet, it's like you're starting at the top of the tree. Yeah. And you're going through all the branches, but eventually you're going to get to the same trunk no matter which way you're going.
Yeah, yeah, totally. Yeah. But, having a little bit more of, like, an open-ended, or I guess open world for exploration could be cool. This is where we get into dangerous territory, because now we're starting to build a game that we would love.
Right, and then we're going to be, building. And then when it's not like that, we'll be disappointed. Yeah.
This is the bane of all Star Wars fans, right, is we talk it to death, build up our expectations, and then they're like, here's a 30-second TV spot where you get to see
the same else. Footage nothing that you've new. Seen already. That was my own fault, just because, like, season one of The Mandalorian had two full trailers and like five TV spots, and we had been getting TV spots after the full trailer for this season, so I was like, this has to be the second full trailer if they're following that same map.
Yeah.
And then when it came, and like I had the game on my TV and I was doing something else because like I had stuff going on that night, and then when it happened and I watched it and I was like, I've seen all that footage. I was like, all that was another TV spot. And I was like, we're not getting a full trailer.
No.
I can't believe people were convinced that they were going to show either Boba Fett or Ahsoka. Like, we're talking about the television series that hid Baby Yoda from everybody. They're not gonna blow that in a marketing piece.
Oh, man. Somebody got flung so far out of the trust tree when that Ahsoka stuff dropped, if it ends up being true. I'm still
on the fence of it not being true, because, to be honest.
I think that whatever they do have cooking in this, if there is like another big Baby Yoda sized reveal, in order to keep it under wraps, that they
gotta throw it. But you could also make that argument. That's what the Temuera Morrison news is.
Totally.
Like I don't think if Ahsoka's in it, I think he's Rex, not Boba Fett. I think Boba Fett's armor will appear with Cobb Vanth, like it should.
Yep.
But I don't think Tamora's going to be Boba.
I think that we have a bunch of mysteries. Which is cool,
because the Boba Fett armor doesn't need to be on him to be there. Like, Cobb Vanth is fine. If he's in Boba's armor, then he's just there then. That's cool. Yeah. It's Cobb Vanth then.
No, and I absolutely would die if we got a post-Return of the Jedi Captain Rex. If we got Temuera Morrison looking like Rex from Star Wars Rebels with even a few more years put on him. And maybe a little bit of an explanation for how he's still alive, because he's supposed to be aging at double the rate.
Right. But
they need to just retcon that and go like, well, until they hit a certain age. It's like it's accelerated growth until they hit like 20, and then it like ramps down and eventually like matches.
I mean, I gotta give Temuera Morrison and Rosario Dawson credit, because they apparently just must not be leaving where they live ever.
Yeah.
Because like people don't like if people get pictures of like Ewan McGregor and you can see his beard's growing out.
Yeah.
Then you know that he's getting ready to film. But, like, if, like, you find Temuera Morris somewhere and he's got this big white beard.
Yeah.
It's like, I know what you were. I know what you were just doing.
Yeah, there's no denying that one. We'll see. And the best thing is like, I love surprises. That's one of the reasons why I think Baby Yoda is just such a great thing for Star Wars. Is because, like, none of us, not no a single person... went into The Mandalorian going like, you know what we're going to get? We're going to get a little Baby Yoda in this. It's like nobody saw that.
I remember it was like a month or two before the first season dropped. Jon Favreau said, the first episode contains something. that's going to shatter the Star Wars universe forever.
Yeah.
And in my head, I was like, I can't even wrap my head around what that could possibly be. That could be this earth shattering. I was like, is Palpatine in this? And I was like, I have no idea what it would be. And then we get Baby Yoda, and I was just, wow. Totally. I was floored.
the bigger part of it is that, like, Dave Filoni 100% has my trust. He has earned that with Clone Wars, Rebels, and season one of Mandalorian. It's like, he's responsible. Star Wars Rebels is my favorite Star Wars.
I love Star Wars Rebels. Right? Yeah.
So it's like, and that is him. Like, that's him on the screen. That's the story that he wanted to tell after he was basically, it's like Clone Wars was his Padawan period with Star Wars under George Lucas, learning how to be a Jedi. And then Star Wars Rebels is, you've been knighted, here's your first mission. And then Mandalorian is when he becomes a master, and now Jon Favreau is his Padawan, learning how to do it. It's like, it follows that so perfectly. So it's like, Rebels to me is just like, it's so much Dave Filoni just right there on the screen. It's the type of characters that he wants to tell a story about, the type of story he wants to tell.
Yeah.
And it so perfectly matches the kind of Star Wars that I love, where it's fun, it's for kids, it's a little bit weird at times, like... The Bendu is about as weird as Star Wars gets, right?
Yeah, and it worked.
but it all respects Star Wars, and it all...
I just think it was funny, though, is, like, I've been a Filoni fan probably as long as you have. Like, basically since the beginning of his career. Totally. Like, even back to The Last Airbender.
Yeah.
And,
Even like when we Disney... didn't even know we were Filoni fans. We were just like, Avatar's really good.
Right. Yeah. And then, But, like, in that Disney Gallery series, it was just so obvious that they're pushing him as being, like, he's going to be the guy. We're getting him there.
Yeah.
Because, and he's even the first one to say is, like, he didn't jump into live action right away because he didn't think he was ready to do it. And he wants to do it right and slow and learn. And as much as I love him, his episodes weren't the best directed of that season. So he does have room to go.
Oh, for sure. For sure.
And, like, there's always the debate of, like, well, is Lucasfilm ever going to do Star Wars episodes 10, 11, 12? Yeah, I think they will. But they're going to wait until Dave's ready and it'll be his trilogy. Because that just feels right. Because he'll think of a way to make it work without ruining anything before it.
Oh, he'll probably fix it.
Yeah. Yeah. If anything, he'll enhance all of them somehow. He'll even make episode 2 look like a masterpiece. He'll find a way to do it. But I think if they do a 10, 11, 12, which I believe they will, probably in like a decade, I think it'll be Filoni's ship at that point. And
yeah, I could see that.
Everyone will love it.
The thought that they will not be tempted to go back to the well with those characters on screen is I think foolhardy.
I don't think they can really go back to any of the legacy characters anyway, just because, like, Carrie Fisher unfortunately passed, which we are recording on her birthday, and, like, Harrison Ford is old as dirt. I don't.
He's done,
He won't stop flying planes. So he's just asking for it. But I mean, I don't think we'll ever see Indy 5 because he's just getting so old. But
yeah. Well, I mean, I think we would have, and then COVID happened and pushed.
Yeah, that probably had a lot to do with it.
And so I think that's gonna mess things up, and we're probably never gonna get that. But I'm fine with that. I'm 100%
right. Same.
Yeah, no, and I'm good with him where he ends it, with his character's final appearance, in the saga. We don't, I don't need Han again. Well, that's not true.
I want young Han. Say that.
I need more Alden Ehrenreich.
Right.
Immediately, hooked directly to my vein.
Solo 2 happen.
Yeah, 100%. But in terms of, like, Harrison, I look, if he were to do a voice in the Lego Star Wars holiday special. I'd be like, that's cool. It would make me happy for sure. Or like really any kind of cameo or whatever. But does that mm-hmm. character need to be back on screen? No, I think like his right. story is told. Their story is told. In the same way that I don't need Obi-Wan to show up in the saga trilogy, in the sequel trilogy, right? Mm-hmm. Like it would it have been cool if Ewan had like done something? It's like, yeah, that would have been cool. And obviously we get the little bits with his voice and whatnot, but like that character's story is done, right? Like it comes right. to a close, especially right. once Luke becomes a Jedi. It's like, okay, when we see the three of them, Obi-Wan, Yoda, and Anakin on Endor as ghosts, it's like, oh, cool. Like this is their happy ending, is that everything that they suffered for and sacrificed for, it worked mm-hmm. out. And then it turns out that none of it worked out, but that's all right. It's right. a different story. Yeah, it's like they like that set of character stories is done. Now this set will be done. If we come back and we tell another story in the main Skywalker saga, it has to be Rey, Finn and Poe as mentors, as leaders, mm-hmm. as like in that elder role, and then a new group again, right? It has to be. That's the way that it
right.
that the story right. perpetuates. So, and obviously Ben Solo has to come back somehow, but that's a whole other thing. How do you feel about that? How do you feel about Ben Solo? This will be our last topic, and then
okay,
and then we'll wrap it up.
About Ben Solo, just overall. I love the Ben Solo part, to be yeah. honest. I really do. I love everything about that whole ending sequence yeah. of him landing, diving down. Ow. I think it
is one line.
I think it's super dumb that Adam Driver, one of the best actors of this generation, the yeah. last line that they gave him was ow.
Yeah.
I thought the kiss was a little weird. I don't really think... I mean, it kind of worked. That's not a big gripe, but I love that whole Ben Solo thing. I was on yeah. board the whole time. I wish we got more of him.
Yeah.
But I'm okay with how it ended.
Yeah, so when he dies, that's you're good. Like, you're like, okay, cool.
Yeah, I don't really think I need him to come back. I think they can do young Ben Solo stuff.
Yeah.
Without Adam Driver. Like, they could do it animated or anything. And that would scratch that itch just fine. Because there's a whole period of time before he starts getting tempted by the dark side that you could make a TV show out of, or a book totally. Or something.
Yeah, I would love to see that. But I am firmly in the camp of bringing Ben Solo yeah. back from the dead.
I mean, I would, if they find a good reason for it, I guess I wouldn't hate it.
To me, the biggest thing is that, like, you go through this whole movie, the final movie, establishing this concept of the dyad,
mm-hmm.
and then you immediately extinguish that at the end of the story, and you leave Rey completely alone. On her own.
Yeah.
And it's like, that was, there's an ideology in Star Wars writers that the Force is a burden, right? Mm-hmm. That like it's like almost like a curse,
right?
And that eventually like you'll pay the price for having all of that power, and so you can't have a happy ending.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, that to me is so antithetical to George's storytelling, especially when you think about the Campbellian myth components of it. It's like, no, like,
right.
It's a fairy tale. It should have a happy ending. And I don't consider the end of Rise of Skywalker to be a happy ending. Like, when the three of them embrace each other, it's like, here's three children of extreme trauma. They've lost everybody. They've lost every mentor they've ever known.
Yeah.
And they are, all they have left is each other.
Mm-hmm.
And so that embrace at the end of the movie is not, it's not the, all similarly like traumatized children at the end of Return of the Jedi who all like stand there and go like, we did it. We've beat the Empire. But there's like there's a hopefulness at the end of Return of the Jedi when you get that last tableau of everybody mm-hmm. standing there for the family picture that
right.
like, you just don't get that. It's not in Rise of Skywalker where it's like, well, so now what are they going to do? Right. Yeah. It's supposed to be a period on the sentence. And to me, it's not.
Because it's like a comma.
It's very much a comma. It's not even an ellipsis, like a dot, dot, dot. It's just like a comma of like, they just stop talking in the middle of a sentence.
Right. Which is really weird too. Cause like the dyad theme, that's another Joseph Campbell thing. Like they tried bringing that back and
it's not though. He mentions the dyad once in any of his stuff and like very quickly moves on. It's Terrio says that it's a Campbell thing. It's not a Campbell thing. Like
Terrio is also like the only person in Hollywood that seems to keep failing upward.
Oh my like, God.
He came
oh
out. My God. And
don't
he
let Greg to, hear this, but yeah, Batman he came out v to Superman. Clean.
But see, the thing is, though, is like Martha. He was brought in to clean up BVS.
Yeah.
So I don't know how much of that was him. But then Justice League came out, which was him. And then Joss Whedon came in and butchered that. So we don't know how much of that is him. Yeah. And then The Rise of Skywalker came out. And that's what we got. Yeah. And that's him. But then WB is paying over $100 million again for him to do Justice League.
Yeah.
So like I don't understand why how he got locked into like this blockbuster zone of poorly received blockbusters.
I'm gonna spoil Justice League for everybody. At the end of the 4-hour movie miniseries event that is Justice League, Wonder Woman is going to reveal to the rest of the Justice League that in fact the whole time her name has been Martha Skywalker. And that's how it ends. And she's just standing in the desert, looking at some ghosts. And that's how Justice League ends. But it, like the comma, like the idea of Rise of Skywalker ending on a comma, I can't exemplify that any better than when I Janna sits down next to Lando, and. And she's like, where are you from? And he's like, the gold system. Where are you from? And she's like, I don't know. And then he goes, well, let's find out. And then, like, that's the last thing that's said.
Right.
In Star Wars.
And it's funny, too.
No, it's not. I guess it's the race. I'm Rey Skywalker or whatever. But, like, that's the last thing that's said by someone other than Rey.
Yeah.
Right? That's kind of the end of the movie. And, like, we just move on to... this postscript at the end of the movie where Rey is
is like that moment with Lando and Janna is so like just out of place in a way, because like when I left the theater I thought it was kind of hinting that she might be Lando's daughter.
Yeah.
But then when one of my friends saw it at a different time and messaged me when his movie got out, he said, so Lando was hitting on that girl, right?
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, so those are two different reactions we're getting from that. So like, that's just how out of place that moment is.
Many of the truths we cling to depend on our own point of view. Right? It's weird. It's so funny how it's like... when they posted that thing, somebody posted on like or not somebody like the Star Wars account posted like, oh, the Sith fleet were crewed by did you know that the Sith fleet was crewed by these Sith worshippers that were trained from birth to be like the perfect Sith soldier, Empire soldiers or whatever. And I think it's Elijah Wood like retweeted it like no, how would we? Like, because it's not in the movie.
Right.
There's no explanation for how all of these ships have people piloting them.
Yeah.
Like all these Star Destroyers that take 2,000 crew members apiece.
Yeah.
There's just no question or conversation about it whatsoever. So like when you say like, did you know, it's like, no, it's impossible to have known that unless you've read the visual dictionary,
mm-hmm.
Which I always have handy. It's always within arm's reach right now so that I can be like, did you know,
right,
Rise of Skywalker, this was apparently part of the story.
Like I feel bad for like Pablo Hidalgo and them, because like they to fill in those gaps that didn't need to be there, but
yeah. Well, and like apparently the whole thing with Janna and Lando is a holdover from a previous version of the script where we learn that Lando had a child,
yeah,
but that kid was kidnapped by the First Order.
Mm. Yeah, and that would make sense then.
If that was the case, then why would he be like, no, I don't want to be a part of your rebellion? He would be like, he would have been in the last two movies if that were the case. Yeah. Like the second that Rey is like, you know, Leia could use a good pilot. He would be like, I'm on my way. Mm-hmm. Like, but I the one mistake in The Last Jedi, the one mistake, everything else I think is fine to exceptional. The one thing that I think was a real misstep is when Poe is like, I know who to call. And he calls Maz Kanata. It's like, why are we now establishing that Poe knows Maz Kanata? It would have made way more sense for Poe to be like, I know who we can call that can find us a codebreaker, Lando Calrissian, right? Like, if anybody knows where we could find a good hacker, it would be the scoundrel himself, Lando, right? And then it would have been a perfect cameo for Lando, and it would have been a perfect way to, like, clue him in, to bring him into the third movie, right? Because he would have been like, oh, I know exactly the guy, you go talk to this guy, right? And it would have set them off on their adventure, and we would have been like, oh, sweet, Poe knows Lando, there's a backstory there, but instead we're just like, Maz Kanata, the character from the last movie that was okay, like, it still makes sense, it still works, but it also bothers me. She's in the same outfit that she was in the last movie. Somehow within the span of hours, she's dealing with a labor dispute with a union or something like that. And it's but The Force Awakens just ended.
Right.
So it's that has never worked for me, but she continues to wear the same outfit in Rise of Skywalker.
And it's super jarring to see her in Rise of Skywalker because for that film, they went full animatronic for some reason.
Yeah.
So, like, you see her and you're like, okay, well, now she's a puppet. Yeah. And it's like, in the first film, she was... Okay, so you couldn't get Lupita Nyong'o back. So you just let her do her voice, but...
Yeah, it's interesting. It's interesting. Anyways, I think we did it. I think we've talked for 99 minutes.
I know.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much, Will, for being on the podcast.
No, thank you.
Good conversation. I would say that it went well. Would you say that it went well?
I did. I had a great time.
Okay, good. So we will do this again in the future. We'll get you on for one of these upcoming episodes of The Mandalorian. And you'll have to pull double duty at some point.
I think I can make it work.
Oh, man. we're asking. It's a big ask to talk about Mandalorian twice in 1 week.
Right.
I'm sure you'll be fine. Well, awesome. Give us a one more plug for your podcast so that everybody knows where to go grab it.
It is the Cantina Conversations. We're available on all of your favorite podcast platforms, and we're also on Twitter at Cantina Convo. So you can follow us on there.
Awesome. And where can people follow you specifically?
You can follow me specifically on Twitter at Papa Star Wars. And then I also stream on Twitch at Papa_Star Wars.
Awesome. You guys know that you can find me on Twitter and Instagram at ArkWulf, ArkWulf. I'll also give a plug for my art Instagram, which is at ArkAngelWulf, ArkAngelWulf, which is just ArkWulf is just the shortened version of ArkAngelWulf. I just plug that specifically because I'm still in the middle of my Draw Star Wars 31 challenge, where I'm drawing a Star Wars drawing a pen and ink, pen and ink. I always say that. Ink and marker usually. Star Wars drawing every day, they're all for sale. So hit me up on either Twitter or Instagram if you see one that you like and you would like to purchase it, or you know someone who would like it, because I think that they would make great Christmas gifts for Star Wars fans. So. I go check those things out, and we will hopefully be back next week with a special episode in our lead up to The Mandalorian, but I'm still trying to firm up plans for that. If not, we will be back the following week, guaranteed, and Matt the Crankster Cranky will be making his triumphant return to Faster More Intense to talk about the first episode of The Mandalorian, so stay tuned for that. Thank you for listening, and we'll see you on the next one. You can follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at Star Wars FMI. If you like what you hear, you can support us in two ways. First, by heading to store.thunderquack.com to pick up some merch, or by heading to patreon.com/thunderquack to kick in with your monthly pledge of support. Your pledge gets you early access, exclusive podcasts, and more. Thanks for listening, and may the Force be with you. Faster, More Intense is part of the Thunderquack Podcast Network. Head to thunderquack.com for more great podcasts.